In this video lecture, we're going to take a look at creating object arrays, arrays whose elements each contain individual objects of some class type. Okay, let's get started. We've already spoken of arrays as being an indexed collection of like-typed items. Well, everything we've discussed so far about arrays is equally applicable to arrays of objects, or object arrays. The only difference is that now, every element of an array is an object reference, a pointer to some actual object instance elsewhere in memory. In this example on the top right, we can declare the CS12 date array called dates and instantiate it such that it can hold 5 CS12 date object references. As usual, we wind up with this array reference pointing to the actual array elsewhere in memory, where all 5 array elements are initialized to null by default. Then once we get around to actually initializing these array elements, each one of them will point to some actual CS12 date object yet elsewhere in memory. As with any other array, each array element date sub I is itself one CS12 date object, and we can do to this indexed element anything we could do with any other regular CS12 date object. We could print it, get its month, set its year, and so forth. Let's take a look at some examples of object arrays. As before, all these examples can be found in the example file array1dexamples.java, and I strongly encourage you to look over this example file in JGrasp or view its code walkthrough as needed. The key thing to understand about an object array is that any indexed element of the array, such as this, is simply an object of the specified class type. Well, formally speaking, it's really an object reference, but for all practical purposes, it is an object, and we can treat it as such. We can use an array element such as this anywhere an object of that class type may appear or be used. Furthermore, all of the methods of that particular class API are available to us by using that indexed element together with dot notation, such as we see down here. This term in blue on the left is one object of that class type, and we can apply to it any of its methods using the typical dot notation. So in this code example on the right, let's say we set up this array of CS12 dates of size 5. Then in this next initialization loop, each element date sub I, like so, simply represents one individual CS12 date object. So here we are initializing all of them to this Christmas date by looping over the length of the array as usual. Then once again in these next statements, each of these array elements is itself one CS12 date object, and we can do to it anything we could do to any old CS12 date object. We can set it to a specific date, change its month only, advance its date, perform assignment statements to it or with it, and so on. Then to see all the resulting dates, we simply iterate through the loop as always and print each date element implicitly using its toString method. Again, this general term for the ith array element is simply one CS12 date object. When this code is executed, here are the resulting CS12 date array elements we print back out. The key gotcha we must keep in mind when working with arrays of objects is that all the elements have null object reference values by default until they are otherwise initialized. This is a key difference from numeric arrays, which have 0 or 0.0 values as their defaults. What this means is that if we try to manipulate any object array element which hasn't yet been initialized, we're going to get some kind of exception error. So for example, if we tried to loop over an entire object array and print all the elements, but some or all of the elements hadn't yet been initialized, our program would crash with an exception error. Therefore, we need to carefully distinguish between the maximum array size, which is always arrayName.length, and the actual used portion of the array, which is something we need to keep track of ourselves. Here on the right is a code example showing what we mean. String is a class in Java, so we can declare and instantiate an array of strings of size 50, as we see up here. Then we'll also declare this count variable and initialize it to 0, which will serve as both the number of string objects in our array, as well as the next available array element index. Then, let's initialize the first 3 elements of our string array as shown. Marley was dead. Here we're not referring to reggae legend Bob Marley, although he too is dead, mon, but instead to the opening line of Charles Dickens' classic novel, A Christmas Carol. For each of these 3 strings, we assign it to the next available element of our string array, and up the count each time. So we assign Marley to the 0th element, up the count to 1, and then that becomes the count of strings and the next array element index. Then if we wanted to display all the elements so far of our string array, this first commented out loop statement is what we would not want to do. We don't want to simply loop over the full length of the array, because only the first three elements contain legitimate string references, and the last 47 still contain null values. If we try to apply this toString method here to a null value, it will give us an exception error, as you can see in the code walkthrough for this example. What we want to do instead is shown here. We loop over only the used portion of the array and print each element as usual, and we have kept track of this count ourselves. So we loop over the first three elements only, printing out the array index and array element each time as usual, as well as this message which shows the difference between the used portion 3 and the total array size 50, giving us this output shown at the bottom. Okay, that's it for now on object arrays. Objects can be the elements of an array too. We just need to remember to keep track of how many there are ourselves.